Welcome to this first event between the Urban Land Institute, Simon Fraser Urban Studies Program, and Simon Fraser City Program. It's just a great pleasure to see everyone here. And also to start on time, this is, I can assure you my classes don't start quite as promptly as this group is. It's great to see everyone here. So my name is Peter Hall. I'm currently the director of the Urban Studies Program. And in my day job, one of the things I do is I teach the research methods class in our program. And that means that I have people in the class who have barely opened an Excel spreadsheet, but they're often really good at constructing a narrative around data and getting us to think about the bigger meaning of what information means. And then I have engineers in my class who are frustrated because we're barely touching the very elementary regression analysis. And it's great because when those two types of people come together and they're confronted with each other, they both have to think hard about what data means and how they're using it and how they communicate messages and get deeper insights through data. Because we live in a world where there's plenty of data, but maybe not as much insight as there could be from that data. So the point of today's event is to open up a conversation about the use of data in the city, acknowledging that there's lots of data flooding around, but how to make the most of it, how to make sure that it's the right data for the right question. That's the kind of conversation we want to open up today with a panel. Really thrilled to be able to present Ibi Mustel from the Mustel Group, Linda Lowe from the City of Vancouver Open Data Initiative, and Andy Yan from SFU's City Program. There are a couple of other people I'd like to thank right now. I'd like to thank Duncan Lorjek, the Vice Chair of the ULI, and also the Director of Partnerships with Vision Vancouver, and also a graduate of our program. Wendy Waters, Senior Director with GWL Realty Advisors, and Shannon Patterson from ULI. Terry Evans, who's not here, is the program person in SFU, Urban Studies, who helped us out with this. So, the format for this afternoon. What we're going to do is we've asked each three of our speakers. So what does it do? It's defaulting back to if I hold. Oh well, what the slide that I can't show says is that we're going to start with brief inputs from our three presenters, and we've lined it up with the idea of a creator of data, a curator of data, and a consumer of data. But of course, they're going to talk across those three roles, particularly when the panel discussion gets going. We've asked them to think broadly about three topics, and I invite you to start defining your questions that you'd like to, comments that you'd like to bring to the panel. The first one is, what do we mean when we talk about city data? What are we including? What's part of the tent? What's changing in terms of city data? The second topic, this is sponsored by the ULI Young Professionals Group as well, is what are the skills that young urban professionals need to know, for that matter, old urban professionals need to know about city data and the landscape, the landscape for the work of city data going forward. And then the third sort of broad area is around the policy and ethical questions that come with data. How do we, who's responsible for making sure that data is of valid, good quality, reliable? Who does that responsibility fall upon to curate data and clean it and make sure that it, when it is used to inform decisions, it's used appropriately? So that's the outline for this afternoon. And I invite our first speaker, Ibi Mustel. Thanks so much.
Okay. Well, it's the first time I've been called a creator instead of a pollster. I think I like that term a lot better. Especially after some of the last elections. So I'm going to, sort of the sequence here too is like sort of creators. So I deal in the world of primary research. So what that means is if there is no available source of information to provide the answers to the questions that you have, then that's where I come in. So Stats Canada only provides so much, and there's lots of great sources of data, but there's also often a lot of questions that you have that are unique to your needs. And maybe just things about attitudes, or maybe reactions to new concepts, new developments. You know, it could be a number of different things where there just isn't that data source available. So that's where we come in. And so what I'm going to talk about is sort of some of the key tools and some of the advantages and disadvantages of each, because it's really important when you are looking at the data that you do look at what the methodology is and you are aware of what the drawbacks are, the limitations are of that data based on the methodology. So I'm just going to give sort of a quick primer. So we have a number of tools in our toolbox. We tend to divide them into two categories, qualitative tools and quantitative tools. So qualitative tools would be things like focus groups, in-depth interviews, workshops, anything that's really where you bring kind of maybe a small group of people together and you have a very sort of detailed, in-depth conversation about topics or issues. And they're really, really a great start to any research project that you're starting, because it really, they cover sort of the range of opinions that people have, the language that people use, especially if you're moving into a quantitative phase or you're developing any kind of communications programs. It's really important to understand that using their language, not your technical language, but using language that's understandable to people. So as I said, it really provides great direction for any subsequent follow-up phases. Problem with qualitative, though, is it's not projectable to the population. If you really have a limited number of people, you may try and make sure your group is representative of, you know, by gender and age and things like that, but it is ultimately still a small group of people, so it's very much a qualitative exercise. In terms of some of the quantitative research tools, so of course internet surveys is one of the sort of big tools. I would have said 10 years ago, we would have thought the vast majority or 90% plus of our data collection is through the internet, and that's not turning out to be the case so much. I mean, there's a lot of web surveys that are done, but there's still many other tools that are also being used for various reasons. Internet surveys, they're very fast, you know, very quick turnaround, and we can launch a survey at 8 in the morning and can have over 1,000 responses, but very, very quick. They tend to be lower cost. They're great for being able to include graphics, audio, visuals, any kind of complex material that people need to review first and have in front of them when they're answering questions. Ideal for sensitive topics, if, you know, it's something you're asking about their sort of personal lifestyle and things like that, people are more comfortable dealing with those kinds of issues on an internet survey. The disadvantage is a lot of internet surveys are very much self-selected, and a lot of times people self-select themselves based on a topic. They say, oh yeah, this topic interests me, or no, it doesn't. So that's kind of can create some biases in the data right there. It tends to underestimate ethnic populations. I mean, we have challenges even with getting youth and doing internet surveys. There's as much challenges with internet surveys as with other tools. But the one really big challenge is the ethnic population. And they don't readily engage in those kinds of exercises. So it's a real struggle to make sure that you've got that kind of representation. And I'm primarily talking new Canadians, first generation. So that's one thing to really look at your sample. So what efforts were made to make sure that you have that ethnic representation, which obviously is kind of more important in the city now. And most panels are not randomly selected. They're based on an opt-in method where people will sign up to maybe collect some sort of rewards or there's some sort of incentive. There's very, very few panels that are randomly recruited. I'll plug in for us. We have a randomly recruited panel that we've built up over the last 10 years. We do not allow people to opt into our panels just because we don't want to have only people who are maybe super opinionated or just doing it for the rewards. But it's very, very rare to find randomly recruited panels. And the advantage of having a randomly recruited panel is that you can quote margin of error. So when you see a poll being talked about in the newspaper, and at the end they'll say it has a margin of error of plus or minus 5%. that margin of error calculations only apply to randomly recruited samples, not to non-random samples. So that's one thing with panel samples. They'll say, oh, on a randomly recruited sample of 1,000 would have this margin of error, but if it's an opt-in kind of panel, typically you really can't. You should be quoting those margin of error, and that's professional standards, actually. Okay, telephone surveys. They are not dead by any means, but in fact, if you're familiar with Pew Research Center in the States, they've done a lot of research on it, and they're very much still alive now with having access to cell sample. We can actually include in our sampling cell sampler again to the city level, even as small as communities as Whistler. So with that, we can assure 100% coverage of households with landlines, those without landlines, by including that cell sample. And we found it's been an excellent way to reach the younger demographics. It's been very, very effective for that. And there's something about if you get someone on the other end, especially it's got to be a well-trained professional interviewer to be able to encourage people to do the survey. But people who don't do any online surveys at all are inclined to do telephone surveys. And we ask actually in our telephone surveys too, do you participate in any online panels? And we often find it's less than 10% that actually are part of some sort of web panel. So it's a great way to sort of really tap to that broader community. Really good if you're really looking at a specific region in the city, cell or internet samples tend to be much more broad-based. It's okay if you're doing the whole city of Vancouver or Metro Vancouver or whatever, but when you're really trying to target like a particular neighborhood, like Pizzalan or something, it's really, really difficult to achieve that through proper internet surveys. So it's great for that kind of application, but they are more costly. And because you do have access to, you do use techniques to make sure your sample is randomly recruited, you can also quote the margin of error. So for example, when we call a household, first of all, the household itself is randomly selected to make sure they're geographically distributed properly. When you make contact with the household, we don't just interview the person who answers the phone. We do a random selection of all the people in the household. And if that person that we've randomly selected isn't available, we ask when would be a good time to reach that person. And we'll make up to 6 calls, sometimes more, to a household to make sure we can do the interview with that person, so it isn't just the person who's answering the phone. The other quantitative research tools, mail surveys, again, it's another way to make sure you've got 100% inclusion. They're really great for small geographic regions. As you get into sort of larger areas, they become fairly cost prohibitive, especially as Canada Post keeps upping their rates as much as they do. It's kind of like mail surveys are almost making a little bit of a comeback. For a while there, people were really getting away from them because response rates were so low, but there's been a lot of research done around them now. With proper incentives and just the way the research is presented, there's kind of a resurgence of what we call cyberspace sampling. So it is being used again more so than it has in the last sort of recent past. IVR, just so that in, probably everybody's gotten that call. Push one for yes and no for two. They're very, very unreliable. I mean, they're very cost efficient, but there's no random sampling of anybody from the household. I mean, it's a very quick and dirty way to do polling, but not reliable at all. Sort of one of the hybrid methods that is gaining a lot of popularity is where we'll do a randomly recruit survey to web, so you really get the best of both worlds. The city of Vancouver, for example, they have their Talk Vancouver, and it's a great tool to get public read on issues and feedback. But when things like transportation planning, for example, where you really need to have precise numbers, what the city is doing is we randomly recruit through the public population. I think it's a combination, it's primarily telephone, but I think it's a combination of some after-state sampling as well. And we recruit them to do a web survey, so it's to keep, basically it needs to be like a diary of all their travel patterns. So on really important critical decisions, that's kind of like now the gold standard of sampling is doing that kind of hybrid method. Okay, other tools, open access community consultation service, that's sort of like Talk Vancouver, and they're fabulous tools, they're great engagement tools, but they have to be careful. You really have to look at the demographics, who's responding to a survey, because for example, the liquor bylaw reviews of the city of Vancouver, they could tell by looking at the sample that's skewed to those who'd like to party. So they had to you know, do some further research to make sure that they heard from the Silent Majority as well. So for me, there's a lot of free and low-cost tools to do almost like a quantitative analysis of what's being said on social media. And it's very useful to have that information, but again, you have to be really careful that it is kind of reflective of the broader population. For example, tweeting, it seems like everybody is on Twitter, but really a regular Twitter user says it's less than 20%, I think it's more like around 10%. So they tweet a lot, but it is not, again, very, very broad segment of the market. And that's it.
Great, thank you very much. So while we're changing over, if there are any immediate questions for Evie?
Yeah, so you said it briefly in your presentation about the ethnic populations that don't respond well. Did you say that with the immigrant communities or could you expand on that a bit?
Was that sorry, last one?
Sorry, could you just expand on what you meant?
Well, I think it's a cultural issue as well. I think a lot of our new immigrants are coming from countries where there isn't a lot of trust in government and authority figures, so there's quite a reluctance to engage in surveys in general. We find using telephone method quite effective. We'll have multilingual interviewers, so the interview can be conducted in the person's language. So there's a little bit more of that trust built that way. So we find telephone quite effective for the ethnic communities, but for kind of that more kind of, internet or trying to get them just to sort of opt in on their own, it's a lot more challenging.
Great, thank you.
Yep. Did you mention that you were able to do surveys with calling people on their cell phones?
Yes.
How do you get those phone numbers?
It's publicly available. I can't give you precisely. We'll deal with a sampling company that actually, what it does is the companies release the exchanges that have been released, so we won't know exact phone number. Like, we wouldn't get a list of like your number, but we'll know what exchanges have been released in terms of cells. So then that database is clean.
What do you mean by exchange?
It's 838-2000. All those numbers have been, so maybe, I'm not even sure, maybe just down to like maybe the first three digits of the phone number. I'm not sure if it's all thousands, but they'll know what numbers have been released are in circulation, and then the sampling company goes through and actually cleans the database, cleans the samples, so see which ones are live and which ones are not.
And do they know something about those people, like how old
no.
they are, or
what
their
names no. are? No, there's no access to, but it is geo tagged, so they'll know, okay, these are the numbers that are, these are the exchanges that have been released in Whistler, for example, or in Abbotsford. So it is down to that level, but no further than that. But there's no privacy issues, or it's again, it's there's a lot of cleaning in the data.
I'm surprised, actually. I'm surprised that we can, we don't get a lot of pushback on it.
I'm quite surprised myself what a good response rate we have, and I think now people are on unlimited minutes.
And people don't ask me, how did you get this phone number?
Yeah. They just say it's randomly generated.
It's not really a different phone number. Oh, in houses, right? Mm-hmm. When you're contacting people's houses, it's not really that different.
That's right, because those numbers are actually
what they're doing is like it's like 604-838 and then you're putting in
001
digits.
Yeah.
It's random.
It's like when you're doing random digit dialing, we do the same. That's the purest way of doing contacting people's households. You don't just do listed phone numbers because a lot of people have their numbers unlisted too. They'll be what you call random digit dialing. Yeah.
So you just know they exist. Like there's actually a number that has a person associated.
Yeah.
And at least know, at least when they claim to want to receive it,
they're not really
calling. Yeah.
Like how do you get like a 10-year-old kid? What does that do for your?
Well, you screen that out pretty quickly. Yeah. I mean, same if you call a household too. You could have a minor answering phone, but you would screen them out.
Great. Okay, so we'll do the same. Manages the operations and the development of the city's open data program. Thanks, Linda.
So believe it or not, the city of Vancouver used to sell some of this data. So business license is one of them that people have to come into our licensing office and pay a fee in order to get the report. But thanks to the Open Data Program, the city now has a webpage that you can go through. It's data.vancouver.ca, and so you can click on that blue button where the arrow is, and you can get an index of all the data set that is available. So the key thing with open data is, in case you're not familiar with, the rule of thumb is it needs to be machine readable. So it's not like it's information from a web page. The data needs to be in a machine readable format so that the program, people can write program to combine different data to do analysis or to do maps and things. And then also there's no personal identifiable information in the data set. So if we have any information that are private, then we'll take it out during our publication process. So wanted to make sure that there's no privacy concern or legal or security concern in there. So here to go to our catalog. Now we have over 150 data set. It has a lot of different varieties. It's all listed alphabetically at the top there. We can find data set like census data, property assessment data, the last municipal election data, so all sorts of different infrastructure data as well. So you can take a look and see what's available. And there are all sorts of different people who use our data. I just highlighted some of the main group. So we have other government agency. Our own city of Vancouver uses the data as well. We have business community developer who use our data to build apps. We got journalists who use our data to support their stories that they're writing. Nonprofit organizations, citizens too, they'll come in and take a look and see how perhaps how the counselors are spending their money. So that's in our counselor expenses data, and of course our FOI requester as well. So instead of filing in FOI requests all the time, they'll look into our catalog to see if there's information available, or they'll contact me and say, hey, do you guys have this information available or not? If not, they might go ahead and file FOI requests through our public access department. So when you use our data, we always wanted to make sure that you guys are familiar with what the information that you're looking at. So we have also different channels that you can ask questions or to verify some of the research that you're doing. Perhaps there's some small questions that you're thinking, oh, I'm not too sure if the data is presenting this way. I'll show you another page that will help answer a question. But there are, so here are some of the channels that you can go through to ask questions. You can call 311. Or you can email opendata@vancouver.ca. I'll get those emails. I'm also on Twitter. And or you can go through the online web form and let us know what kind of project you are working on, what kind of data set. It will be helpful for you to do your research, perhaps. That would be beneficial for us. And then a lot of the times, because our catalog is available 24/7, we find that we have a lot of downloads on the data set, but not necessarily caring about how people are using our data. And that's important because there are times that we're not sure if what we're publishing the data is helpful for your research. So sometimes there might be people coming in to let us know and say, hey, if you just have this one extra data element, that will be very helpful for our analysis. So those are the feedback that we'll like to know, and then knowing that how you transform our data to support your analysis, that will also help us as well. It's like, oh, okay, that makes sense. Okay, now I can look at the data differently. Because a lot of times the data that we have on our catalog is what we collected, but the intent of how we collect the data or how we use the data might be different than from how you guys are using the data. So it's always good to have a different perspective and look at the data from a different lens. So in our open government license, that essentially is is basically saying anybody can use the data, even for commercial use. They're free to download it and use it however they want. All we ask is just for people to include that attribution statement that is bolded in black, contains information licensing under the Open Government License Vancouver. So for that, the purpose is to make sure people know that the information are coming, like the source of the data, and then for us to have a way to find out how people are using our data as well. So this is every one of the data set that we publish, we also include a data description page or call it a metadata page. So I always wanted to highlight, we put a lot of effort to try to explain the data set that we're publishing. So we're including things like how current we're keeping the data, what's the description of the data set, of course, and the accuracy comment. But any limitation that this particular data set perhaps is not down to the survey accuracy, we'll include that into this page. So always pay attention to the data description page when you're doing your analysis. And then also the attributes as well, under the bottom there, it has a specific definition for each of the attributes that we publish. So I was asked to talk about the landscape of the data. So like I mentioned before, we typically are publishing data that are collected by City of Vancouver. But then we're starting to get into different sources. So this is one of the pilot projects that I did with the cultural services. So this data set actually was started from looking at any online sources about the cultural spaces that's available in the city, and then having that as a base. And then after that, there's also the online survey that we ask people to take a look at the data and see if there's any cultural spaces that are missing. So we call that as a crowdsourced data, so volunteer data by the public. So people, the public will be going through that survey, the little fill-in form on the right there, if they see there's any data, any cultural spaces that are missing from our list. So with that, we do have to go through another validation process to make sure what people put in are accurate. So we found that there's different feedback as to, is it better to actually go out there to find the information ourselves, or doing the validation process afterward to making sure that the information we do provide is correct. So there's a hit and miss, depending on the topic, because there are times that it seems like if 10 people said there's this cultural space is available, chances are it is correct. But we do still have to make sure that it is 100% accurate before we post it. So seeing the trend, the accountability that Peter was talking about, how do we make sure whose responsibility it is to make sure that the data is accurate, who's accountable, how resource intensive, how costly it is, like how do you do the balance between all those factors. And then also with the big data and sensory data, that's another big thing. It's huge volume of data coming very quickly. whose responsibility is to make sure that the sensor data or the sensor it's functioning the way it's supposed to be, is calibrated all accurately and all that, so we can make sure that we have accurate data.
So those are some of the thinking that we're currently have to start considering.
So just wanted to put that shameless look. If you guys have any more questions, please let me know. I can take some questions right now.
I have one question.
Sure.
The company I work for, we use your open data quite a lot, especially building footprints, infrastructure stuff. Do you know if that information is going to be updated? I know like the link footprints are 2009, and some of the infrastructure is older, and it's great, but do you have, mm-hmm. are there plans to
We do have newer building footprint data now. newer than 2009.
There was another 9 or 2011.
Yeah, I think it was 2009.
Is that just Vancouver, the village change?
Yeah, it's costly, especially like the LiDAR data. People ask a lot. It's very expensive to produce. And before we have the license agreement, we have to wait for 2 years before we can publish that data. We just recently were able to waive that requirement with the company. So there is that contractual requirement involved, and then also the resource available to happen.
That's great that you can have that LiDAR stuff, because I know like Calgary, Victoria, a lot of places that you can have.
Yeah, because it's very expensive. Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. Nice. And we're having it available for free, right? So yeah. You have to justify it.
No, that's it. Free.
So I've been working for a number of municipalities in Alberta and across the prairies, and they're all stuck on a cost recovery model for their data. Do you have any tips on how to move an organization away from cost recovery to open data? Or is that just a very long conversation?
No, I would say, like, using my example about the business license data, City of Vancouver used to sell business license data, but looking at the numbers, administrative costs of processing all the bills and invoices and all that is actually more costly than to just post it onto the website so people can download it 24/7 and then they can just do the work. The cost for us is to, of course, refreshing the data and then storing the data and then going through all the publication and making sure all the information is accurate. So that will be one of the business case for that. And then we can talk more, like I got more examples as well.
Sure.
Yeah.
That's great. I'm sure we'll come back to that question in the discussion. Any more questions? Either people, Linda. Okay, thanks. Thank you, Linda. That's the map that horrifies or thrills everyone. Pretty horrifying, really. He's also now recently become the director of the city program here at SFU. And he's intending to follow up this this session with another one of his data cafes on February 3rd, I think. And has also left a questionnaire if you have a moment to just give some indications of who you are and what priorities you might see for some of the programming that Andy has planned in his new role. So over to you, Andy.
Well, thank you, Peter. It is indeed a career goal of mine to become the Stephen King of the Peter. So, you know, the next issues will be coming out very, very soon. So really, I think in this discussion of data, your city, really what's one of my biggest messages? It's, well, frankly, data is the new water. That fundamentally, it's the idea that data is all around us, it's ubiquitous, you know, we are swimming in a sea of information, and yet underlying that information is actually deep implications towards how economies work, how societies function, how democracies, for the most part, work kind of most of the time, and let's see what happens in the U.S. But that really common part of this is just understanding that data is now part, a key operational part of making cities work, as much as roads, as much as transit. Very much it is part of the understanding of a new set of utilities in the 21st century. And from that perspective, it's the source of new industry. I use this image because it's the idea of how data becomes the basic resources of how industries can form. One of the apocryphal stories of why the semiconductor industry evolved in Silicon Valley was the fact that it was the provision of clean water, that the water was clean enough through which they could begin this mass manufacturing of microchips. Of course, one apocryphal study. And I think within that discussion, really the changes of data and how it's been remarkable that within a few decades, really how much data has changed and really how knowledge has changed and the extent that what used to be locked into these little shells, into exactly the story that Linda talked about. This is actually one of the last chained chapels in England, talking about how rare, how difficult, how closed information was in medieval Europe, that very much up until recently, the approaches really could be said about data. that data was really about stalking the source, about being an anonymous network. Well, I don't know how you guys roll, but that's certainly how I did. Getting information for my thesis was to really haunt the data providers, to break this type of monopoly on knowledge. And yet, I think one of the biggest challenges isn't necessarily now dealing with a monopoly of knowledge, but then ensuring that there's an infrastructure, that there's fundamentally an understanding that there is an infrastructure that needs to be supported, that needs to be funded. Otherwise, alternatives, like the service, begin to go back to that chaining of information. That it is about emailing the respective city councils, emailing Gregor, saying that we support the open data catalog, that otherwise, utilities fall apart. This is incidentally a shot of the new water treatment plant over on the North Shore. And this is part of the core of how cities work today. But I think in that kind of discussion, it's making sure data is clean. That one of the biggest challenges is making sure that what's put out there is filtered. That frankly, a bad data set can really mess you up. And ensuring that quality is there and coming into that conversation in terms of understanding the limits and the strengths of a particular data set, whether it's provided open data or whether it's data that you collect. And then that point is really connecting the big ideas, not only big data, but to big ideas. And what is that? It's beginning with a question. It is beginning with understanding a problem statement. I am absolutely mortified the fact that the idea today is somehow a little data will fix it. It's kind of put a little bird on it. Well, a little data will fix it. You know, you sit in conferences, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars have been spent sending people all over the country to this conference. And the first question is, tell me about the data. Not about the response, by the way, is what's your problem? What's that discussion of the problem you're trying to find? And you'll find that any data work, and I think the data work I personally hold the highest, actually begins with a question. Coming to that conversation is then understanding that ear data. And of course, everyone's talking about really the discussion of methodology and technologies. That's obviously a big thrill with really the kind of era in terms of the internet, in terms of the development of social media, and really all the kind of metrics that evolve from those changes that are almost less than 20 years really in this liberty. And from that discussion, I think it's also understanding that data actually sits between economy and society, and that really this is a relational type of discussion. Data does not sit by itself. It has its biases, it has its strengths, and again, it has its limitations. And from that perspective, it's really the connection between data, methodology and technology, between economy and society, but then also within this discussion, politics. Really, who gets what, where, and when? And fundamentally, that's actually how data can benefit, particularly this open and transparent data can form into that underlying well for democracies to operate. And really, what is also part of the question is navigation. That fundamentally, big ideas allow you to navigate in a world profusely filled with data, that this, I think, begins to understand, like, anybody read Noise and Frequency, Nate Silver's book? The discussion of itself, that it's the end of theory, that very much, we don't need theory anymore, we can just pursue it through data. But the fact of the matter is that theory provides the constellation through which you can navigate through mounds and gigabytes or terabytes or petabytes of data. And of course, one of the biggest issues is also making sure that you're in North America as opposed to, say, South Africa. So this constellation actually works in that way. And so from that discussion, it's also creating infrastructure and culture. That it isn't only the physicality and the technicalities and making sure there's infrastructure, but we have to realize that culture is, well, we'll create a certificate program, you know, we'll create courses around that. But fundamentally and underlying that, we need to connect it up towards an infrastructure, not only within SFU, but then connected to the rest of the community, whether it's the city of Vancouver, the region, or to the country. But then underlying even this perspective of infrastructure, it's an understanding of culture, that we are still at the dawn of data culture, that what makes things work are people, not software. And that understanding the strength of cities is networks. That is the sole reason for cities to exist, going back to my own bias in education, is network. And that understanding that how we move forward towards a data strategy is towards increasing and diversifying a culture. And really, big plug for really our data cafe, Friday, second, 6 p.m. There's the hashtag, you get information off of there. But fundamentally, that's also the response from my team. But it's coming into that discussion that is the connection of people.
Friday's the third?
Third, crap. Okay, back to that. Within a certain confidence interval of Monday. So, look, you'll have our off days too. But we get to that. Thank you. But that's what the hashtag is for, you can confirm. Thank you so much. You always have one in your crowd. Coming into that discussion. And finally, really the idea that data has cracked, that it is something that is organic, it changes over time. And I think about this in actually a talk I often give to my planning courses, and it's talking about this map. This is a map generated by Paul Rayner. Does anybody know Paul? Paul is, shall I say, a data god. Is that correct? Is that a correct summary? A data god data god? Yes? No, you're not. Okay, maybe a legend just experienced a certain generation within the city of Vancouver. But this map is generated in 1979. And in 1979, he decided to map all the values of single-family homes in the city of Vancouver, the RS1 values. And really, this is his documentation of how RS1 values look like in 1979. This was done by himself, as well as a planning assistant, a graphics artist, and then I think there's another person within the picture. That took him, I believe it was something like 3 weeks to gather the information and process, and to process the information to even produce this map. As you can see, it was pretty important to kind of get the sailboats to make sure that, the little sketches are in there. As much as the categories, the chloroplasts were reflecting of the population. Incidentally, if you were curious, the average house value, single family house value, was $80,000, which is about $350,000 today for a single family home. As you can see, homes back then topped out at $300,000 somewhere in the Southlands and also West Point Grey. You're curious how that translates, that's about $850,000. So things have slightly gone up over the last 30 years. And really, it's kind of taking an understanding that as craft, it changes with technology, it changes with culture. I roll in, and this is a summary of really what we found, that I roll in with this. This is my very first map using the first open data set in terms of property values in 2010. And really, it took me about 2 days to kind of get this together with me, Excel and ArcGIS. So you really kind of see how the craft has changed over 30 years, what it used to be. And also, perhaps some of the major employment changes that are ongoing. Yes, one person takes the job of four in really a slight cut of time compared to that previous generation. And really, what does that perhaps mean towards the industry, towards data culture? I think that's really one of the interesting challenges moving ahead, is that really we often talk about how the automotive industry is being affected by robots and automation is displacing workers. Guess what, planners and analysts, we could be right there. And really, what are that kind of discussions of making us somewhat unemployment vaccine, I think is what I'm trying to create. So coming into that discussion, it's really how do we kind of even from this point, even now getting into within my own data as craft, that I moved from this kind of early cut in 2011 really to how does this map look in the latest data set that Linda's shop just released? Any guesses? $1 million map line? Correct. That's precisely what's happening. And really how like one's data work is craft, that you change, your data changes. And really I want to close with this image of a toolkit. And this is reflective of perhaps the toolkit, the data toolkit that Peter owns and operates in his practice. Mine tends to be a group of rocks in a plastic Safeway bag, but that this, I think, presents how data work is something that is done over time and experience, and how to develop it over the past year. Thank you.
Okay, so thanks so much to three presenters. The